Are we ready to worship? Okay. Then we gather together in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll light the fourth candle. This most holy of days, nights, brings us gladness, grief, and joy. Gladness, because you left the splendor of heaven's glory to come to a dark and cold world, to bring the light and warmth of your kingdom to a world so in need of your love, your peace, your joy. Grief, because you came to the world, yet the world did not receive you. You came to your own, and you did not welcome you. And still today, people turn away from you. I turn away from you. Sin still scars your creation and the hearts of your people. And joy, because you offer perfect forgiveness and full cleansing to all who acknowledge their need of you. Cleanse my heart tonight, Lord Jesus, so that I may welcome you as I long to, certain that I am also welcomed by you. Amen. The Lord has heard your prayer, and in his love, he forgives you all of your sins. Because of what Jesus has done for you, you are forgiven. You're forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, well, let's greet one another with the peace of the Lord. Please greet people. Let them know how much you love them and that you're glad that they're here worshiping with us. Let's continue with the reading.
The Old Testament reading is from 2 Samuel chapter 7. In this reading, David desires to build a temple to the house of God's earthly presence. God responds through the prophet Nathan that God does not need David to build an earthly temple, but he himself will build a house through David. God was referring to the everlasting kingdom that he would set up through David's descendant, Jesus. When the king had settled into his palace, and the Lord had given him rest on every side from all his enemies, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "Look, I am living in a cedar house, while the ark of God sits inside tent curtains." So Nathan told the king, "Go and do all that is on your mind, for the Lord is with you." But that night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go to my servant David and say, 'This is what the Lord says. Are you to build me a house to dwell in? From the time I brought the Israelites out of Egypt until today, I have not dwelt in a house. Instead, I have been moving around with a tent as my dwelling. In all my journeys with all the Israelites, have I ever spoken a word to one of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I committed to shepherd my people Israel, asking, 'Why haven't you built me a house of cedar?' So now this is what you are to say to my servant David. This is what the Lord of armies says. I took you from the pasture, from tending the flock, to be ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have destroyed all your enemies before you. I will make a great name for you, like that of the greatest on the earth. I will designate a place for my people Israel and plant them, so that they may live there and not be disturbed again. Evildoers will not continue to oppress them as they have done. ever since the day I ordered judges to be over my people Israel. I will give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you, the Lord himself will make a house for you. Your house and kingdom will endure before me forever, and your throne will be established forever. This is the word of the Lord. Next is Psalm 89, 1 through 5. This ancient Hebrew song celebrates the Lord's faithful love. Let's read it responsively. I will sing about the Lord's faithful love forever. I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations with my mouth. For I will declare, faithful love is built up forever. You establish your faithfulness in the heavens. The Lord said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn an oath to David, my servant. I will establish your offspring forever and build up your throne for all generations. Lord, the heavens praise your wonders, your faithfulness also in the assembly of the holy ones. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 16. This reading is the closing paragraph of Paul's letter to the Romans. Paul reminds the Roman readers that God can and will strengthen them. Then he closes with a shout of praise to God, who has revealed to us the mystery of his love. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation about Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery kept silent for long ages, but now revealed and made known through the prophetic scriptures, according to the command of the eternal God to advance the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles, to the only wise God through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory forever. Amen.
I guess we're both going to miss out a little bit. All right, good morning. It's so nice to see you today. I think Jake knows what this is, but do any of you know what this is? Girls, there's a manger there, right? Because we're in Advent and we're waiting for the coming of who? Who's coming? Yes. Now, my Advent calendar, my manger scene is a little empty right now, so we're going to add some things to it, okay? And Kaylee just said who we're waiting for. Jesus, right? Jake, can you put Jesus in the manger for me? Thanks for coming up. All right, who else is there? When we're waiting for Jesus, lots of people were there, and maybe some animals too. Can you think of anyone else that was there when they were waiting for him to be born? Can you sit down? I'll see who I have. Jake, I need you to hold it up. Maybe, Bo, you can hold it up for everybody. Can you hold it up then so that they can see? Okay. Let's see who else I have here. Oh, you know, sometimes things are difficult. We just keep going. Let's see who else I have. Oh, what do you suppose this might be? Ain't loud, Jake. Wise man? Yeah, do you know how many there were that visited Jesus? Do you know? Three, yeah. So let's see if I can find all three. There's another one. I know. Here, you can put the third one on. Okay. Disorganized today. Let's see who else is in here. Oh, there we go. He's got a crown. So sometimes we call them kings, right? Seeing we three kings. Do you know anybody else that might have been there? The shepherd. Kaylee, you got it. There's a shepherd right there. Can you hold that up nice and high, Jake, so we can see? I know. And another shepherd. Wow. Oh, and there's one more. Oh, that's okay. Maybe he needed to go find a sheep. So we need the sheep too, right? So here's a sheep. Jake, why don't you, or Bo, why don't you put a sheep on there? Another sheep. Oh, that's okay. There's another sheep. My goodness. Now the wise men came, and look, they've even got a black sheep because there's, what, a black sheep in every family, right? That in there? So, that's for the grown-ups, I think. So now the wise men. How did they? They did?
Well, maybe they could have walked some of the way, but they'd have tired feet. I'm going to go and hold this up so they can see it. You can see right there. You can sit down now, Jake. I'm going to do the rest, though, but I would like you to go sit out there with the girls. Can you please listen? Thank you. Okay, so they had to get there somehow. Hey, Bo, I need you to go sit down. Thank you. Jake, you too. Remember we talked about this. So they probably maybe rode in on some camels. Wow. Thank you. So I've got a bunch of camels here. So we've got wise men, we've got shepherds. Oh my goodness, but we're missing someone. Who announced to the shepherds that Jesus was born? Oh, no, no, sit down, sit down. Thank you. The angel. Yeah, so Jake, can you put the angel way up there in the sky? Okay. There we go. And I love how the girls are sitting. I would like that you boys sit down too. Bo, can you sit down with the girls?
Lily, sit down.
Okay, put those down.
Good job, Lily.
Okay, we're almost done. But you know what? Jesus is in there in the stable. He's missing two very important people. Nope, Jake, put him down. Who would be there with a baby when they're born? It's usually with a baby. Two people that take care of you when you're a baby. Mary and Joseph is mommy and daddy. Now, hold on.
Lily, sit down.
I'm going to put
Lily.
Joseph in there. Thank you.
Lily.
Let's see here. And then the last one. Nope. I need you to go
Lily,
sit with the other girls.
Lily,
I'm not
going to
continue until
you.
You're
sit
sitting
down,
because then they can't see. Thank you. So the last person I want to add is someone that Kaylee mentioned. And we're going to hear about her in the gospel message today, I believe, or we might have already heard a little
bit about
her.
We're going to hear that next.
We're going to hear it next. So she was a very special person. She was Jesus' mommy. And her name was Mary. So can you say Mary?
Mary,
yes. Can you sit next to me and look at Mary? Yes. Now, she was Jesus' mommy. Can you imagine being the mommy of God, baby Jesus? Wow. So she was very special. An angel came to her and told her that she was going to have a baby and that he was going to be God's son. How do you think that she felt? Surprised, maybe? Maybe excited? Can you sit next to me? Sit right there. She probably felt a lot of amazing things. But you know what? She also, more importantly, trusted God. Because when something comes into your life that might be new or scary or different, you can trust God that everything's going to be okay. And Mary did trust him. And baby Jesus was born. Can we fold our hands to pray?
Okay.
Dear Lord, we thank you for today.
Dear Lord, thank you for today.
For the chance to gather.
For the chance to gather.
Like those who did.
Like those who did.
So long ago at the manger.
So long ago at the manger.
Help us to remember that joy.
Help us to remember that joy.
Every day of our lives.
Every day of our lives.
And as we think of difficult things.
As we think of difficult things.
We think of Mary.
We think of Mary.
And how she trusted you.
And how she trusted you.
In your name we pray.
In your name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so
Very
much.
Good. You guys can go to Sunday school now.
Please rise for the gospel. Holy Gospels from Luke chapter 1, 26 to 38. In today's special good news, God sends an angel to tell Mary that she will become the mother of the Savior. This young teenage girl responds with faith, trusting that God can do what he promises. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man named Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." But she was deeply troubled by this statement, wondering what kind of greeting this could be. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Now listen, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end. Mary asked the angel, "How can this be, since I have not had sexual relations with a man?" The angel replied to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. And consider your relative Elizabeth. Even she has conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month for her who was called childless. For nothing will be impossible with God." "See, I am the Lord's servant," said Mary. "May it happen to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. This is a special good news of the Lord. O come, the rod of Jesse free, thine own from Satan's tyranny. From depths of hell thy people save, and give them victory o'er the grave. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring from on high, and cheer us by thy drawing nigh. Despise the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou key of David, come and open wide our heavenly home. Make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path to misery. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Good, as we come before the Lord, and what a wonderful song to remind us of our waiting for Jesus to come. Let's pray together. Father, as we prepare to hear your word, we pray that your Holy Spirit will be with us, that you'll speak through your word and help us to just be ready for those interruptions in our life, that we can allow those interruptions to become opportunities to serve and love in the same way that you serve and love us. Help me to be able to speak clearly, and help each one of us to hear you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So are any of you planners? Anybody plan? Yeah, you like to plan? Some people are more planners than others, but most people have some sort of plan. Sometimes they're big plans, like, you know, what you might do in the next couple of years, and you kind of have this vision of how your life's going to go. Sometimes they're short-term plans that you use your Google Calendar, and sometimes your plans don't work out as well as you'd like to. Like that little beaver there, poor guy. He was planning to make a dam, and it didn't work out the way that he had planned it. Mary, I'll bet you, had a plan. I'll bet you that Mary, she kind of figured out what was going to happen with her life. She grew up. It was a pretty clear vision. You live in this culture, and so you knew what the expectations for a woman would be. Her family had arranged a marriage with Joseph. She might have known him, or she might have met him only once, because sometimes what would happen is that you would be engaged to a man, he would come, and his family would come, and they would make the deal with your family, you'd meet him, and then he would go back to build the house, and then you wouldn't see him until the wedding was going to happen. And so she was in that waiting period, but she kind of had an idea that someday her husband-to-be would come back, they would get married, they would establish a family, live with her father-in-law, and he would probably work in Sepphoris, this city nearby Nazareth. He was a craftsman, a carpenter, or a craftsman of some sort. So she probably had an idea of what her life would be like. But one day, while she was going about her business, an angel appeared to Mary. And that changed everything for her. The angel appeared and he said, read with me, "Greetings, you who are favored, the Lord is with you." With those words, Mary was troubled. Because angels didn't just show up to people, right? They don't do that now either. You know, most of the time we're not having angels show up to us. And so she was worried, what does this all mean? And she had no clue how it would change her life. Read with me. "Then the angel told her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Now listen, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus.'" So here's Mary. This young woman, she had these plans, and all of a sudden this angel comes and says, "You know what, Mary? Not going to go as you plan. You're going to have a baby." And then later she finds out she's not even going to wait until after she gets married, right? That she's going to be pregnant by the Holy Spirit right then and very soon thereafter. Her whole world is changing, and it's going to make a big difference in her life. God interrupted Mary's plans. God interrupted her life. Read with me. "For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him." Mary was chosen to be the mother of God. And in one respect, we think, oh, great, good deal. What a wonderful thing. What a wonderful honor. But it wasn't always that easy. Her being chosen to be the mother of God also meant that she would suffer with Jesus and along with him. Immediately, she has this problem. She's a young, unmarried woman, pledged to be married to Joseph, and now she's pregnant. We don't hear how it happened, but she had to go and tell her parents. Can you imagine that conversation? "Mom, Dad, I'm pregnant. It's by the Holy Spirit." Yeah, like, you think her parents are going to believe that? I mean, she knew that God was going to take care of it, but I'm sure that she went through some angst and some struggle before she had that conversation. Would have been very difficult. God interrupted her life. And then she knows that somebody's got to tell Joseph. She's not going to be the one because she probably hardly knows the man. But her family's got to send the message. And then there's the community that's going to be talking about her. I mean, this message from the angels really changed her life. Not too long after, she is pregnant. She's getting pregnant. She has to take this trip. Because her husband's family is from Bethlehem. So he's got to take her down to Bethlehem because of a decree from the Roman Emperor. And so her world is changing again. And she goes there, and they're in a land where her family's not around. She has a baby, and not in a 5-star hotel or a wonderful hospital, right? She's in this little manger. She has to lay her child there. Sometimes people say, well, it was not in the guest room. Regardless, it wasn't in a nice place. It wasn't in the place it was supposed to be because there was no room for Jesus. So Mary has to deal with all of those different things. And then shortly thereafter, Herod wants to kill the baby. And so they have to take this long trip to Egypt. Now, I don't know if she rode a donkey or if she walked or how she got to Egypt. But that's a long way before there were cars and the like. And she has to make this big trip. stay out there for a couple of years in exile, having to be a refugee. Mary and Joseph and Jesus. Yeah, not what she was planning in her life. It was a big interruption in her life. And then, when Jesus grew up, she had to stand at the foot of a cross and see the son that she grew to love, the son that she loved so much, and see him hanging on a cross, knowing that he had done nothing wrong, and suffer and die. Yeah, this wasn't the life that she had signed up for. I imagine if we look back at our lives, there's times that we look and say, you know what, some of the stuff in my life I didn't sign up for either. I didn't want it to be this way, right? But God interrupted Mary's life. But I'll bet you, even with all of that, I'll bet you Mary wouldn't have traded it. I bet she wouldn't have traded it for the world. See, Jesus had to die, but the other thing that Mary got to experience was that Jesus rose again. What an amazing thing. This whole thing about Mary's life reminds me of a quote from Dietrich Bonhoeffer. When Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die. Mary had to die to the expectations of the life she thought she was going to have. She thought she was going to have this normal life that all the girls in her little town of Nazareth had. She thought she was going to live her normal life, but God interrupted that life and gave her a totally different life than she expected. But I think it was worth it for Mary. Can you imagine growing up and knowing Jesus every day, being able to talk to him as a child growing up, and as he grew up to be a man, and having that special relationship with him? Imagine, even though you had to stand at the foot of the cross, you also got to stand outside of that empty tomb and to know Jesus had risen from the dead. And so this is an incredible thing for Jesus, for her. God's interruptions lead to suffering, but the rewards far outweigh the cost. Far outweigh the cost. The angel went on to Mary. Read with me. He will be great and be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end. I think this is interesting. What the angel said to Mary was not, hey, this Jesus, he's going to be the Savior. She said, look, he's going to be the King. He's going to be the King. He is going to usher in a new kingdom. This is what people have been waiting for generations and generations. Even as far back as Genesis, they were looking forward to a king that would reign and would bring God's reign to the earth. And this Jesus was going to be that one. Now, people's expectation of that reign was different. They thought it would be, he would be a kind of a military king like David, but instead, he was a king that was crowned on the cross with that crown of thorns that was put on his head. Yeah. One of the really interesting things about Jesus becoming king is that it happened at just the right time. Read with me. When the time came to completion, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. In the Bible, there's two kinds of time that it talks about. It talks about time as chronos, which is like chronological, you know. It's the ticking of the clock, tick, 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 tick. You know, it's right now I can't see what time it is back there. It's 10:36 or something like that. That's chronos. That's the time. You know, that's what's going on. And this verse says, when the time came to completion, when the clock ticked the right amount of times, when the calendar got to the right date, then Jesus was born. And it was just the right time that he was born. But the Bible also talks about time as kairos, which means like an opportunity. Just in the nick of time. We were going to do our children's service, and just in the nick of time, Melissa got here, right? That's kairos. You know, that's seeing time not as the ticking of the clock. She wasn't here on a schedule, but she was here at the right time to be able to do that children's service, for our children's message for us. And that is the kind of time that he talks about in this verse. For while we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. And so the point is, we may not be ready for those interruptions in our life. We may never be ready. when something changes. How many of you last March were ready for the coronavirus? Yeah, nobody, right? I mean, our time is never right, but God's time is always right. God's interruptions are always at the right time. And when we get that perspective, it helps us, because sometimes things happen not the way we expect them to happen. And sometimes they change our world, like Mary's world was changed. But we know that God's interruptions are always at the right time. And that allows us to continue to move forward and serve Him, knowing that no matter what interruptions come into my day, God's got it. He's got it planned. Now, let me back up a second. There are two kinds of interruptions in our life. They're kind of like Mary had, you know, the big interruption that changes our whole world. And there are those that happen, the coronavirus, some of those real big ones. But there are also interruptions that happen that are just little interruptions. During your day, somebody comes and talks to you, you weren't expecting to talk to you, those kinds of things. And there's a quote here, I think it's from Dietrich Bonhoeffer again. Read with me. We must be ready to allow ourselves to be interrupted by God. God will be constantly crossing our paths and canceling our plans by sending us people with claims and petitions. What Bonhoeffer says is that, look, those interruptions, those aren't just random things that are happening to your life. God is sending those people into your life and those interruptions in your life. God has ordered it so that those are opportunities to serve. We tend to be like this lady over here, you know, put up all the barriers. We don't want anybody to interrupt us. We've got our plans. We're going to do it our way. But God has a way to do it. He says, no, it's in those interruptions that you have opportunities to serve. C.S. Lewis says it this way. The great thing, if one can, is to stop regarding all the unpleasant things as interruptions of one's own or real life. The truth is, of course, that what one calls interruptions are precisely one's real life, the life God is sending one day by day. What one calls real life is a phantom of one's imagination. What C.S. Lewis is saying is, he's saying, look, we think this is our life and that this is what it's about. My plans, it's my life. You want to know how to make God laugh, right? You tell him your plans. That's, I think Woody, whatever his name, said that. But the thing is that it's not our life. It's God's life. And so those interruptions are part of that. That's part of what God does for us. There's a story, and you've probably heard it before, so I won't go into great detail of it. A woman received a letter from Jesus. She opened it up and says, I'm going to go to your house tomorrow. Oh, she was excited. So the next day, she got up early in the morning to try to get ready for everything, for Jesus coming. She thought, wonder what Jesus likes to eat, you know. So she was trying to prepare food for Jesus and trying to clean up her house, trying to make sure that all the pictures on the wall, anything that was bad, she was trying to get out of her house because Jesus was going to come to her house. And as she started this, all of a sudden there was a knock at the door. And she came out to the door, and there was these people standing there, and they said, hey, we ran out of gas down the street. Can we borrow like a gas can and a few bucks to get some gas? Yeah, I'm really busy right now, but okay. So she ran in the garage and she grabbed a gas can, gave it to him, gave him a couple bucks, and they went on their way. And she went back to getting ready for Jesus. So she's working and working and working. Before too long, along comes her neighbor, Esther. She goes, oh no. You know who Esther is, right? She's this lady, she loves to talk. She just loves to talk. She's like, I am so busy getting ready for Jesus. Here comes Esther. Esther knocks on the door. She goes, oh, okay. So she opens the door and she talks to Esther. Esther had some problem with her sister, and she goes on and on and on and on. Spends about an hour with her. And she's like, okay. So she listens to Esther for all that time. And then finally Esther goes on her way, and she gets back to going to get ready for Jesus coming. Before too long, there's another knock on the door. She comes out there. What is it this time? And there's a homeless guy out there. He says, hey, I know I don't want to bother you, and I don't normally go to people's houses, but I am just so hungry. You got anything I can eat? She says, okay, great. So she runs in the kitchen, she grabs some stuff. She's been preparing some stuff for Jesus, so she's got some food, gives it to him, and sends him on her way. And then she finishes preparing and gets ready, and she sits down, and Jesus doesn't come. Jesus doesn't come. She's really disappointed. She goes back and rereads the letter, and yeah, he was supposed to come today. The date's right, everything's right. Next morning, she wakes up and there's another letter. She picks up the letter, and the letter says, "It was good to see you yesterday." She says, "What in the world? Good to see me?" Yeah, she says, and the letter says, "And thank you for the gas and for listening to me and for the food," right? Those interruptions were actually Jesus coming to her, because whatever you do to the least of these, you do unto me. If we look at Jesus' life, that's how he lived. His ministry, his service, you could even say Jesus' whole life was focused on those interruptions. You remember Jesus was going to heal Jairus' daughter, had an important mission. Some woman reached out and touched his cloak, was healed from a bleeding issue. So what did Jesus do? He stopped and ministered to the woman and loved her and cared for her. The Canaanite woman, he's going through this Canaanite region, and she stops and wants Jesus to heal her daughter. And so Jesus stops and has a conversation with her, finally heals her. You remember blind Bartimaeus sitting on the side of the street. "Jesus, Jesus!" Jesus is going someplace, and he just keeps yelling, and his disciples say, "Hey, shut up. You're going to bother Jesus. He's got important things to do." What does Jesus do? He stops and comes over and heals Bartimaeus. The women bring their children to Jesus. Disciples say, "Jesus is too busy for this, guys. He doesn't have time for this kind of interruption." But what does Jesus do? He blesses the children. He says, "Hey, bring them to me. Bring those kids." See, all the way through Jesus' life, the interruptions were really where the ministry happened. And if we're going to follow Jesus, it's the same thing with us. You think of Jesus teaching in the synagogue, and this guy with an evil spirit is there. Starts yelling and disturbing and interrupting the service. And so Jesus stops teaching and goes and heals the man. We see Jesus walking into Nain. He's coming into this village. And he sees a funeral procession coming out. Jesus got all these people. He's too busy to deal with this. But what does he do? He stops and brings the man back to life again. Jesus always stops whenever there's an interruption to minister to people and bring healing. And so if we're his people, we do the same thing. God's interruptions are opportunities for us to serve. So I think it's important for us this week, we who have received the love of Jesus, we who know that he died for us and rose again, that he's our king, we want to look at those interruptions in our life as opportunities to serve, opportunities to love people that Jesus has brought to us. So what have we learned? God's interruptions lead to suffering, but the rewards are far outweigh the cost. Sorry, I added a word. God's interruptions are the always at the God's interruptions are opportunities to serve. So what do you think about that? I mean, remember, as we listen to God's word, it's not supposed to just go in our head and out. But what's going to, you know, what you want to interact with that? Anybody have any thoughts or feedback? Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good. Yeah, because it's so easy to see interruptions as something that's taking us away from our purpose instead of saying, you know, this interruption is God's call on my life right now. Okay. So what's going to be different in your life now that you've heard this message? Embrace the interruptions. Well said. Yeah. Pay attention to where Jesus might be in the midst of that. Yep. Yeah. Focus on what's the most important things. Yep. Amen. Okay. Let's pray together. Father, thank you. thank you that you interrupted your time in eternity and came to live for us and to die for us. And thank you for giving us the opportunity to serve. We pray that you'll move our hearts and our minds by your Holy Spirit to be open to the opportunities, to your interruptions in our life. Allow us to love and serve in the way that you want us to love and serve. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's continue with the Apostles' Creed. A creed is a statement of faith. It's something we confess. So let's confess together. Please stand. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. Let's pray for the whole people of God and for everyone in their various needs. Almighty God, we give thanks for all your goodness and bless you for the love that sustains us from day to day. We praise you for the gift of your Son, our Savior, who saved us and forgives our sins. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, for your Holy Church, for the means of grace, for the lives of all faithful and just people, and for the hope of the life to come. Help us to treasure our hearts all that you have done for us, and enable us to show our thankfulness in lives that are wholly given to your service. Send the light of your truth into all the earth. Raise up faithful servants of Christ to advance the gospel, both at home and in distant lands. We especially pray that your word would flourish in the nations of Cabo Verde, Senegal, and Mauritania. Preserve our nation in justice and honor, that we may lead a peaceable life with integrity. Grant health and favor to all who bear office in our land, the President, the Congress of the United States, the Governor, the Legislature of Washington, and of all of those who make, administer, and judge our laws. Help them to serve this people according to your holy will. Take from us all hatred and prejudice. Give us the spirit of love and order our days in your peace. Prosper the labor of those who work to bring peace and justice to the nations of the world, that mutual understanding and just ordering of society may be increased among all peoples. By your word and Holy Spirit, comfort all who are in sorrow or in need, sickness or adversity. Please feel free to mention the names of those who are on your hearts or minds. All of those with cancer, especially we pray for Lynn and Travis and Denise and Dawn and Patty and Tony, Jason, Mary, Veronica, and Gary, who found out that he has to go through chemo. Be with Jim, and we pray that the doctors will be able to figure out how to get his heart regulated. Be with Kathy. I pray that you'll can help the doctors to figure out what to do about her gout. For all of those affected by COVID, for those in nursing homes, we especially pray for Nancy G., for Nancy Gustafson, for Pastor Garcia. For Brenda, we pray especially that you'll keep her husband Mark safe, as he has many health issues that would make COVID very difficult for him. And for all of those affected by this terrible disease. Lord, for Mike Landstott, we continue to pray for healing for him. lift up to you baby Matmat and baby Matmat's family, who is struggling to be able to provide for him in the hospital these many months he's been there. And we lift up to you Corey. And all of those we have named in our hearts, bring consolation to those in sorrow and grant to all a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. All these things and whatever else you know we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. We pray the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Father, we thank you for the offerings of your people. Thank you that you've provided for us and allowed us to be generous people. We pray that you'll use these offerings for the extension of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.